of having my comment, make sure something you have it. Testing. Testing it, I'm on. Testing it, somehow I know.
Then talk.
Testing, testing.
You need to put the mic up closer to you. Okay, yes.
Just way too big, my shirt's such a long. Us ladies have to worry about that all the time. My pockets are too narrow, and the belt that.
What do you use, a hand gun?
No. Just warned me of footballs. Usually I say it's an honor to be here, to be in the house of the Lord. There is no other place that I'd rather be. There is not the best hospital in the world that I want to be, not the best prison. There is no, like, Six Flags, there is nothing that I want in the world except to be here preaching God's word. I don't know if I want to teach, because it's been a long time since I've taught. I don't know if I'm going to preach, because it's been a long time since I've preached. Last time I preached, I think we had time to get three out. So I try not to stay that long. I try to let you out of here early. But let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dearest Heavenly Father, I thank you. Oh, how I thank you, Lord, that you brought me back where I belong. And Father, bless each one this morning. Open our ears and our hearts and our spirits and our souls. Just open them up, dear Lord, and let me be used as a vessel for you. And Lord, take my lips, take my tongue, and clear it so that everyone can understand. Lord, bless each one here mightily. Bless the word that I am to give this morning. For you gave me this teaching, Lord, and you told me to teach it with power. And Lord, you know my desire is to please you. So Lord, I will do the best that I can be only because you're the best that you can be. Bless each one now. And Father, I give this sermon to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. I'm so thankful that I see my youngest daughter here, Angel. That's surprising. I thank God you're here. But thank God that Dina is here.
Amen.
Gone through such a bad this week. Now, you say, well, you didn't go through it. She did. No, she's my daughter. When she hurts, I hurt. When she's happy, I'm happy. It's like our Father in heaven. He feels what your needs are. He knows when you're happy. He knows when you're sad. He knows all about you. And that's the way I feel with Tina. But something happened. She woke up one morning and she started choking. I mean, just choking. And that wasn't enough. But she woke up, she went to bed that night. She woke up, she took a bath, she was clean from head to toe. She woke up with something terrible in her hair. Something terrible was in her hair. And she said, Mama, look at this. Look at, what do you think this is? Well, I didn't say anything. I knew what it looked like. I won't say anymore. But she took a bath, she washed out her hair. And then that day, she started vomiting and getting shortness of breath. And she got terrible migraine headaches. So I talked her into going to the hospital. She's very hard-headed. She won't do the things when I tell her to do them. She likes to go about the opposite way. So I stopped bothering her. I let her beside Bert's help. At 2 o'clock in the morning, that's when we finished our third lunch break, because we sell tacos at, I call it Powerton, but it's at the mall. We do three lunch breaks serving tacos to the guys that work there. Well, at 2 o'clock in the morning, she couldn't breathe. She couldn't hardly walk. So I rushed her to the hospital, and immediately they took her in, and they said, "You're not having a heart attack, but there's something wrong with the valve in your heart." So we went from the Pekin Hospital to Methodist. They transferred her by ambulance. When we got there, they assessed the problem. They said, "You have double pneumonia." Double pneumonia. And if that wasn't enough, they checked her again. They said, "You got a blood clot that's almost in your heart." And I say, we went through the same. You can imagine what I was going through. I was almost on the floor, dying. They immediately went in through her veins, through her arms. They could not find a blood clot. Someone was praying. Someone was praying. And I thank you for whoever it was I was praying for. The blood clot, if there was one, was dissolved. But that was not the end of this problem. The next day they said, "Well, because we went in to the valve of your heart, you now have staph infection." I don't know if any of you know about staph infection, but it's very serious, especially when they went and opened her heart. So a day later, she had no symptoms. That was gone. Someone was praying. And then after the staph infection, they again examined her, and they said, "You've got meningitis." They said, "She has meningitis." Well, a few days later, the symptoms of meningitis went away. There's no symptoms. But the doctor wanted to find a symptom, so they wanted to do a spinal tap on her. And this, she put her foot down. She says, "I'm not taking, you're not going into my spine. Doctor, what will happen if you go into my spine?" The doctor says, "If I miss, you'll be paralyzed. But paralyzation is worth a chance." Dennis says, "Not to me, it isn't." "Oh, you can't do that. Besides, doctor, what would you do if I did have meningitis? How would you treat me?" The doctor said, "I'll treat you the same way I'm treating you now." So Dina said, "No." Then her body functions were all right. So they're gonna let her go. On the day that they're releasing her, her heart rate was speeding up and going faster and faster. They had to give her medication to put the heart rate down. She got her headaches back. She started vomiting again. She got a temperature, and then they didn't release her. And she says, "Mama, enough's enough. I'm going to be demanding to go home." Well, she did, and she came home. The day she came home, she started to feel good for a minute. Then her body surged back into the things that put her in the hospital in the first place. And she said, this is what she said, "I feel the same as I did when I went in. I feel the same way as I did when I went in." What do you think, not being a doctor, what do you think is happening to her? It is an attack of the enemy. It is Satan. It is Satan. I tell you right now, she can't breathe. The doctor said her lungs are perfectly clear. The pneumonia is almost gone. There's nothing that we can find wrong with you. But she cannot breathe. She cannot breathe. She is the worship leader. She cannot breathe. What is it? The enemy is trying to keep her down. Since the very beginning of man's existence here on earth in the Garden of Eden, Satan has been using every weapon, every Dina. You see, not only does he destroy Dina, what does it do to those who Dina teaches? What does it do to the worship team without Dina? What does it do with the adult Sunday school teacher, which is me? What does he get by this? He knows that by tapping on her life, it taps on all of our lives.
Sorry.
How many lives did Dina touch? Throughout the ages, Satan has lied. He has deceived. He has blinded the eyes of men from seeing the truth. Well, this morning I say, we see the truth and we call out for what it is. It is like black and white. Black being the enemy, trying to get the white being Dina and destroying her. Well, Satan, I told you, I preach a message against you. I told you, if you mess with my children, I will preach until I draw my last breath on your tactics. Amen. 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 He has darkened minds. He has turned their hearts away from God. And he has brought sin, sickness, destruction, and death into this world. From the day that the church was born, Satan has been doing everything to destroy it. He has been doing everything to destroy it. It is up to you. It is up to me. If we will allow this to go on, we will not allow these things to go on. Now is the hour, not tomorrow, not next week, not next year. Now is the hour when Satan is going to unleash an all-out attack against the children of God. Do you realize this? Do you realize the time we're living in and how God, how Satan is going to try to destroy you? He destroys you in many ways. You must, as a Christian, recognize these tactics. You must observe him. He tries to get you through TV. You know, there is nothing that I like more than after a busy day of song tackles, of going home and resting. And one of the ways I like to turn to the TV set and I like to see what's going on. Well, one day, Pastor, I was in the house and my son came over. And I like to have the TV on just for the sound because I'm by myself. So I was in the kitchen cooking, and my son came over, and I saw her come in the living room, and she's standing there with a shock on her face. I said, "What's the matter with her?" She showed me the TV, and they were having sex on the TV on a regular channel. She goes, "You're watching this, you're watching this." I know!
Touch anymore. Like, how are you? Have you had the United States? There's no such thing
they're sitting there and they don't want to be disturbed. Well, I heard, I just was done it yesterday just to hear from the Christians. And there's one woman, she was a Christian. I won't tell you her name, but she's on there. And she was mad because now the Facebook has a thing that if you have Messenger, the government got a hold of it, and now they can see everything you're doing on Facebook. They can see you through the camera. That you have no private lives anymore. It is all out in the open. So one by one by one, I see people getting out of the Messenger. And by the way, I have Messenger. You'll never see me on there because I don't go on there. I stay myself away because I know the enemy. He gets you through the internet. Oh, the internet. One time I was trying desperately to do my Sunday school lesson. I really was. And I was on, I think it was on the internet. This is quite some time ago. And I thought, well, I'm gonna type in to get a recipe. So I typed in and I put a simple word on there, a fat recipe. And what popped up was not a fat recipe. It was a fat woman with no clothes on. Oh. No clothes on. And I thought, this is not what I want. I want a recipe. I want this. So I'm trying my best to get out of it. Because I know what you look up on the internet, it registers on the computer. And Dina will come in and see that. And she'll say, Mama, what are you on this place for? And so I was a mess. And Satan, we know, how does he work? He works through people. He does. He works through people. And when you are at your most lowest moment, you're very vulnerable to the antics of people. And it upsets you. I know when I was worried about Dina, I kept saying, Lord, take this worry off me. I shouldn't be worrying. Certain people should be here to pray, and they weren't. And when they weren't, it got me upset, and I started crying because I thought, oh, they don't love me here. Well, anyway, this is the thing the enemy puts on your heart. If it is Satan's plan, listen to this. It is Satan's plan to stop us from moving out in the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit. It is his desire to stop us. Do you realize that? When you are happy and worshiping and you say you got the power, when you walk out the door, the enemy is laughing. We'll see how much of the power they have. That's when you need it the most. Not in here, but out there. You've got to hold on to that. To tear down the strongholds. He tries to tear down the strongholds in your life. Now, we are living in a day. I want you to listen to this. Listen to this carefully. We are living in a day when every born again child of God must be able to recognize and know the enemy. You must recognize him. Our pastor is always giving us examples of things through boxing. Now, it is like a boxer going into the ring. If you go in, you're gonna have a fight. Now, let's say you're gonna fight against, what's that cartoon, the little girl? Oh, what's the Spanish girl's name?
Dora.
Let's say you're going into the ring to fight against Dora. Well, you don't have to train very much. You can just tap her and she's gone. But what if you take that same attitude, like a lot of us do, we take that same attitude and walk into the ring against Muhammad Ali. And that tells you the age of which I came from. But you saw Muhammad Ali there or Tyson in the boxing ring. And you did not get yourself ready because you thought you were going against Zorro. Let me tell you, people, if you've never heard this before, Satan is not a Dora.
Satan is not a dog. He is powerful, but yet happy, because we have more power than he has. We have more power, and inside the power, we have the anointing. You know what that means? When you got the anointing of God, you can do things that you never dreamed possible. This week with Tina God, I found out I can do things that she never thought I could do. I was flying around food cars. I was perfect. I was coming in there. And you know how hard it was. And before, I said, I can't do it. Well, this week, I got the anointing and the power of God. And he showed me. I can do anything.
Yes.
And I praise God for that. Yes. But we as Christians, we have to understand our opponent. That is why, listen to this. Not that bad. Now listen to me. That is why we're launching an all-out offensive attack on Satan.
Yes.
We are ripping the mask off of him, and we're showing him for what he is. We must recognize, number one, how he is attacking Christians today. Look at what he's doing to Nina. He is trying to attack her in ways that he will be sure she will not get up and sing. Today, she gave him a black eye.
Amen.
She gave him a black eye. But that is a start, Nina. That is a start. The key, we must recognize the key strategies he is using against us. If it don't feel right, it is the enemy. It is the enemy. We must recognize how to recognize him and his works. Where the battle is fought and won, we do not fight him on his territory. Why not, Pastor? Why do we not fight a battle on their territory? Do you know why? That's because they'll win. We'll lose. We fight them on our grounds. We do not fight him on his territory. We must recognize how to counterattack and conquer him. Like the boxer I told you about, you have to know your opponent. In the past, the church has failed to recognize Satan and his word. Why? We have failed to take our position of power and authority over him. But the time has come for us to expose Satan.
Yes.
Expose Satan. I've heard some of your prayers. No offense, but I've heard some of your prayers when you go against the enemy, you say, "Go away, Satan. Don't bother. Please don't. Lord, don't let this happen." No, you gotta know how to pray. That is the important thing. You must know how to pray. We have failed to take our position of power. We have failed to take our position of power and authority over him. That time has come for us to expose Satan. Look him in the face. Don't run from him. Many of us, through fear, we run. When I was sitting in that hospital room, one doctor, two doctors, three doctors, four doctors came in and told me the worst things that were taking over on my baby. I remember the first doctor said, "Well, listen, when we get on that table and go through her heart, she could die. But looking at her, she looks healthy enough to
through it. I said, they're frozen. I was honestly frozen. And they're wheeling her off to do the procedure. I couldn't even cry. My mouth was just open. And I know the Lord sent his angel, because there come the chaplain. And he took me, he says, I know your word. Don't be. He has to say that to everyone. She'll be fine. And it wasn't but 15 minutes. It should have been a procedure that at least an hour long. In 15 minutes, it was finished. It was finished. And we went into this room to wait for the doctor. And I was witnessing to the doctor. And I was telling him how good God was. And I was listening to him, and he was in amazement of the things I was saying to him. This is God. This is God. He picked me up from my desperate hour. And he put me on that mountaintop and gave me hope. And this is what he'll do for you. He gives us hope in the darkest hour. He gives us hope. But Jesus knew the enemy. He did not go into that ring, Pastor, without knowing his partner, his sparring partner. He knew who he was. He took immediate action. And through the power and anointing of the Holy Spirit, he took authority over Satan and he rebuked him and cast him out. Jesus did that to show to us we have the same power that he does. Did he not say we would do things that he did, but better? Didn't he say that in his word? Before he can launch an attack on Satan, first of all, again, know your enemy. You understand where he's coming from. You know his characteristics. Did you know that he's a smooth talking guy? Have you ever met those kind of people that are smooth talking? I mean, they are so eloquent in their talk and in their presence that you are subject to do anything that they ask because you believe their honesty. My son met up with one of those this week. On a roofing job, he met up with a man that was an eloquent speaker. The man promised him everything. He said, you do this roof and I'll pay you at the end. Well, it was a two-story building. Martin climbed up there and he did the job. He worked many hours and even through the night. And then it was time for him to get paid and the job was finished. He went to his house and the guy skipped town. Did not pay Mario. Did not pay him. You see, he was a smooth talking guy. And this reminds me of the way Satan's strategies are. You recognize the strategy. You recognize it. When Dina, now the strategy that the enemy uses on Dina, why is it in her airway? Why? Because she's a worshiper. She leads worship. She leads worship. And why do you think that she has headaches? Why do you think that you have headaches? There is an enemy with his hands upon Dina, pushing it. Because when you have a migraine, you don't feel like nothing. You don't want to talk to anyone. You don't want to think about anyone. All you want to do is stay in your house, lay down, and rest. And that is the strategy he is using upon Dina. Well, it is not going to work. You will recognize him and not be taken by surprise when he shows up. Amen? Amen. Will not be taken by surprise when he shows up. Satan was known as Lucifer, the highest and most beautiful, most powerful, and wisest creation of God. He was very prideful. You think of Satan, you just about see him, although you don't want to look at him, you see him for what he is. He was very prideful. In Ezekiel 28, 11 through 19, let's look at Ezekiel 28, Would you read it, Pastor? Could you read pretty fast?
Moreover, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, take up a lamentation for the king of Tyre, and say to him, Thus says the Lord God, You were the seal of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering, the sardis, topaz, and diamond, beryl, onyx, and jasper, sapphire, turquoise, and emerald with gold. The workmanship of your temples and pipes were prepared for you on the day you were created. You were the anointed cherub who covered. I establish you. You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked back and forth in the midst of fiery stone. You were perfect in your ways from the day you were created till iniquity was found in you. By the abundance of your trading, you became filled with violence within, and you sinned. Therefore, I cast you as a profane thing out of the mountain of God, and I destroyed you, O covering cherub, from the midst of the fiery stone. Your heart was lifted up because of your beauty. You corrupted your wisdom for the sake of your splendor. I cast you to the ground, and I laid you before kings, that they may gaze at you. You defiled your sanctuaries by the multitude of your iniquities, by the iniquity of your trading, therefore I brought fire from your midst. It devoured you, and I turned you to ashes upon the earth. All who knew of you among the peoples are astonished at you. You have become a horror and shall be no more forever.
Amen. Lucifer was perfect. He was a sinless spirit being. He possessed a free will. He could go anywhere he wanted to and come anywhere he wanted to. Of all the created beings, he was a sum total of perfection, perfect in beauty and full of wisdom. Look at verse 12 again. Verse 12, Ezekiel 28, verse 12. Son of man, take up a lamentation upon the king of Tyrus, and say unto him, Thus saith the Lord God, that sealeth of the sum full of wisdom and perfect beauty. He was perfection. Lucifer held an exalted position as an anointed cherub. Now, Satan has different names. We know him as Lucifer, but there is another name, the anointed cherub. He is known by. This was a high priestly function of leading creation and offering worship unto God. Look at verse 14 in Ezekiel 28. It says, Thou art the anointed cherub, that is his name, that covereth, and I have set thee so. Thou wast upon the holy mountain of God. Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. So we see his priestly function. As anointed cherub, Lucifer was given the privilege, think about this, he was given the privilege of standing in the presence of God. He is so beautiful. There's no fault found in him, and he adorned himself with the presence of God. All the jewels that the pastor read about, he had all the jewels of topaz, of amber, of all these jewels he wore because of his perfection and the gift that God gave to him. In Ezekiel 28:15, we read, Thou wast perfect in thy way from the day that thou wast created till iniquity found in thee. Until God found iniquity in him, he walked in all good ways before God. In the Amplified Version, it says about Lucifer, You were blameless in your ways from the day you were created until iniquity and God were found in you. Doesn't that sound like someone you would like to hang with? Doesn't it? He's rich, he's got diamonds, he's handsome, he's beautiful, he's got all the right boots. But something happened. Because his purpose is not always from the day he was created until sin came in the picture, he was conceived in his heart. His heart became filled with pride. Are you telling me that pride is sin? time I thought to myself, was I really ever prideful? And I thought, yeah, I can remember a time. I remember it was in school, so now I was a teenager. And I wasn't looking so good. You know, my hair was not a good perfect hair today. And I didn't have the right cool clothes that the teenagers wore in that day. I remember my father, he picked my clothes out. And I wore this dress with a big bow in front of it. He picked out from me. It was the kind of dress that you would see in the roaring 20s. Well, he made me go to school like that, and I was crying because I know I looked ugly. But something came up to me and said, "That is a cool dress, man. You look sharp."
Real. He is a spirit being. Just as Jesus
upon the earth through evil spirits and through the lives of children, the children of disobedience. Ephesians 2 and verse 2, Pastor. Read that to us. Ephesians 2 and verse 2.
In which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience.
The sons of disobedience. Those are his demons. Those are his demons. So just as the Lord has angels that work for us, Satan has demons that work for him. And those are the ones that are attacking us. From the beginning of Jesus' public ministry, he took offensive action. Listen to this. From the beginning of Jesus' public ministry, he took offensive action against Satan and his evil spirits. He was prepared. Was he not? He was prepared, full of and controlled by the Holy Spirit. He did not do anything until he had the Holy Spirit upon him. But when he had the Holy Spirit upon him, he was full of control to confront the enemy, not by his back and whisper, but he confronted him face to face and took authority over him. And we can do the same thing. We can do the same thing. And Jesus began to teach and minister to the needs of the people. He was so full. He was so full of the Holy Spirit. And the words were so full of power that the people were amazed. They were amazed the way he talked and the power he had. They were amazed at his teaching, for his word was authority and ability and weight. Luke 4 and verse 32. Luke 4 and verse 32.
By the presence of the evil spirits. He rebuked him. Now, in verse 35 of Ephesians 28, look at that. Ephesians 28. No, I'm sorry. Ezekiel 28 in verse 35.
Demon to
into heaven and to mess with people that have gone on to receive their rewards or to mess with any of his angels. You don't see that because you do not see it in heaven and you know it is not there. It should not be allowed here because you're living in the kingdom age. And the kingdom age is fulfilling the prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not, dear Lord, into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever and ever. It was not given to you for one day only. It was given to you forever and ever and ever. You have to only believe it, you have to believe it, and you have to take your place in God's kingdom. But most Christians, I tell you the truth, most Christians are afraid to talk about Satan. I know I was when Dina was in the hospital, going through all that she was going through. I did not want to even whisper in the name of Satan because I thought I'm going to upset Satan to the point where he's going to really lay down to Dina. And I'm thinking, oh God, that's not me, that's not me. But I was worried and I would not even refer to Satan or talk about it until the Lord had to remind me that my fears that are upon me, I'm free of those fears through the anointing and the power. So I stood up, I got my thoughts together. I said, Satan, when I go to church, I want to preach a message, and that message is going to be against you. And it's not going to be a quiet message. I'm going to shout, I'm going to sing, I'm going to pray, I'm going to praise, and I'm going to command the enemy of our soul, of our finances, the enemy of our health, to be gone and to stop the nonsense that he's doing. Satan, why are you doing this? You know you're not going to win. You know you're not going to win. We are going to be made whole in the name of Jesus. We have power. We have authority. We have the Holy Spirit to guide and lead us. So do not be afraid. I was at the point of fear, but now I'm not. God has given you all. He's given you. He's given me the opportunity and the authority to rebuke that demon and send him back to the sides of the pit. I don't think, I might be wrong, Pastor, I don't think we can send the enemy to hell, but we can send him to the walls. Am I wrong? We cannot send a demon to hell. That's where he came from.
Right.
But we can send him to the sides of the pit.
Yes. We don't have the authority to cast him to hell.
No, we do not. We can send him to the sides of the pit. Command the spirit. Rebuke him. Command the spirits of infirmity to stop attacking your body, to lose their hold on the lives of your loved ones. I come to the hour when I said what I was going to say and say. And I mean everything I said. And he knows it. He knows it. He knows that I mean business. Because if I have to crawl, if I have to crawl and stop breathing, I will forever tell someone that they have the authority and the right to command Satan to leave them alone. Do you remember, was the last week or 2 Sundays ago, Felicia stood here with cancer in her body. Do you remember that? And the Lord spoke that night. I was to pray for him, but little did I know the kind of anointing that would come. that started and in the bottom of my stomach, and it rose up, and I was on fire. I was on fire for 2 days. I thought something was wrong with me, but I realized it was the anointing. I would pray for Alicia, for the enemy to get off her body. When she went to the doctor, she was cancer-free. Yeah. Yeah.